I need a motion to go into closed session.
As permitted by Section 3-305B of the General Provisions Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session to review the personnel and transportation reports, to discuss collective bargaining, to review the FY18 budget, to review school band uniforms, to consider alternatives for military service credit, to consider students leading pledge during open session, to invite board members to have lunch at schools with superintendent and principals, to review meeting minutes from January 4th, 17th, and 18th, and to review upcoming school activities, meetings, and or events.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion to go into closed session? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Welcome to the Board of Education meeting. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for county citizens to review on QACTV, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table. During this meeting, we ask that you turn off your cell phones and or pagers and hold personal conversations and comments outside the meeting room. We will now stand and be led in the Pledge of Allegiance by Queen Anne's County High School student board member Paige Todd.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I need a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
I have a motion and it's been second. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, we'll move for the vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. I need a motion to approve the minutes for January 4th, 17th, and 18th.
So moved.
Can I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, we'll move to the vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. And next we'll move for the recognitions, the Shining Star, followed by the Energizer Bunny.
Great.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Tonight, we would like to express our appreciation and thanks for the efforts of our talented staff and our students. Tonight, we'd like to recognize our Energizer Bunny Award. The QACPS Energizer Bunny Award is given to an employee or volunteer who just keeps on going. Would Mr. David Carter please come forward? Mr. Carter does just keep on going. His energy is endless and his hard work always shines through. This award is sponsored by Mr. Chip Brittingham and Mr. Wayne Humphreys and Mr. Mark Humphreys at Bayview Financial. Gentlemen, would you please come forward? This month, Director of Operations, Mr. Sid Pinder, has nominated David Carter, who's our countywide custodian foreman, as this month's Energizer Bunny. As foreman, David oversees 72 custodians who are responsible for cleaning 1.4 million square feet every single day and making sure that the buildings are ready the next day for students, teachers, and parents to walk through the door. David is truly the meaning of an Energizer, who is always charged up and never needs to be recharged. David begins his daily routine around 5 a.m. making sure the buildings are open and ready for the day to begin, along with covering for any custodians that might have called in sick for 15 buildings in our system. When David's day is over, 11 hours later, he is still on call with his phone and constantly rings with custodians having questions or alarms going off. The Energizer Bunny that David is, he gets up in the middle of the night from a dead sleep to go inspect any building that has a fire alarm to go off. Just this past week, David laid down to sleep to recharge his batteries when he was awakened by family and neighbors screaming that David's next-door neighbor's house was on fire. David jumped out of bed and without hesitation ran outside to inspect what was going on. The neighbors informed him that they were not sure if all the kids were out of the house. Without hesitation, David grabbed a fire extinguisher out of his truck and ran upstairs out of the house that was on fire, cracked open a door, and extinguished the fire. This is the type of dedicated person that David is. After all of that, David was back up and working again at 5 a.m. David, thank you on behalf of the Board of Education for your dedication and commitment to Queen Anne's County Public Schools. We're blessed that you're on our team. Let's see if we get a couple pictures. Not just yet.
Shouldn't Sid be up here too?
Yes, Mr. Pinder. Thank you, Matt.
Thanks,
right here,
guys.
Mr. Pinder. Right here, Mr. Pinder.
Under the bus you went.
Our next award is our Shining Star Award, and would Miss Regan Baker from Kent Island High School please join me? How are you?
Hi, good, how are you?
Congratulations.
Thank you. Stand right there.
The Queen Anne's County Public Schools Shining Star Award is given to a support employee who goes above and beyond to help QACPS every day. This month's Shining Star is Regan Baker, a senior at Kent Island High School. She was nominated by her dance teacher, Miss Amber Wright. Please come forward. She's one of the recipients of the All-State Dancer Award. In December, Regan was judged in the areas of ballet for 1.5 hours in modern dance for 1.5 hours. This process is not only strenuous on the body, but also emotionally strenuous as the judges walk around the studio closely, monitoring and evaluating the dancers' techniques. Regan is not only the first student of Kent Island High School to receive this award, but she is the only student to receive this award on the entire Eastern Shore of Maryland. Ms. Wright is very proud of Regan and all of her hard work. She has worked extremely hard to get to this point in her life. With endless hours of rehearsal for two or more dance studios and two or more dance companies, Regan has never skipped a beat. She has been able to juggle school, studios, and companies as well. Regan is now a senior who has been accepted to the University of South Carolina, where she had to audition to get into the dance program. Regan stands as a true testament that with hard work, perseverance, support in a support system, dreams can indeed become reality. Thank you, Regan, for being such a great representative of Queen Anne's County Public Schools, Kent Island High School, and the entire Eastern Shore. On behalf of the entire Board of Education, we're so proud of you, and thank you for being a wonderful student. Whoops.
picture, but, yep. Step.
That's pretty cool.
Thank you.
We want to do Christmas purple.
Thank you. Congratulations.
I believe that's it.
Okay, Louise. Because you know what I told my teachers?
I feel like I'm the thing in my life.
No one wants to see me dance.
Here you go, dear. Here you go, sweetie.
As two graduates of your school system, we say thank you.
Oh, yeah. Wonderful.
Next, we'll have our citizen participation and public comments.
We ask all speakers to keep in mind the following guidelines. Speakers should sign the roster, including their telephone number and address. Comments should be limited to 2 minutes in length. Comments longer than 2 minutes should be submitted in writing. Questions or statements to the board should relate to a recent agenda item, an agenda item that is expected to appear in the future, or a matter of general policy over which the board has authority. Please do not discuss items related to negotiations. Those items are to be discussed at bargaining table. Citizen participation is not intended to be a question and answer session. If you have specific questions, the board will make sure an appropriate staff member responds to your questions at a later date. The board respects your desire and right to convey your message freely, but ask as a courtesy to this board and our citizens that you respect the board's request to refrain from naming citizens and name calling when offering your critique. The first on the agenda is Richard McNeil.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Richard McNeil, and tonight I'm doing two things. One, I'm gonna give a comment on my own, but I want to start off representing the retired educators group. And I know that having gone through the process of putting a budget together as principal and supervisor, I know the task and the challenge that makes, and I know that you're in the process of doing that. I want to thank the board on behalf of the retired educators group for the support they have given in the past for the healthcare. And we all know that healthcare costs are rising nationally and even locally. And I thank you for your support in the past. And as you put the budget together, I ask for your continued support of that for those who have left the system after working with our children for such a long time. We thank you for that. The other thing is I'd like to, one, personally thank Sid since he brought it up. I in my other role, I go to a lot of schools, and it's nice to walk in and see a clean, shiny school. And you know, so thank you for you and your staff and everything. And excuse me, it's nice to recognize that in that aspect. I had one other thing, I forgot it. I apologize. Old age and retirement group. Thank you for your time.
Welcome. Thank you.
Think of it, you can come back.
The next on the list is Sabrina Rush.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hi, my name is Sabrina Rush, and I am the president of Queen Anne's County High School SGA and the Northern Eastern Shore Association of Student Councils. In years past, student government participation has been very, very low. This past year and current year, student government participation has increased 600%. To continue to grow student involvement, we have partnered with the Maryland Association of Student Councils. Through this partnership, we have been able to attend conferences such as Fall Leadership Conference, Legislative Session, Advocacy Day, and the MASC Convention in Ocean City. At these conferences and events, students have gained valuable leadership skills that will aid them throughout their lives. Our attendance at these events is crucial to growing involvement and therefore the student voice. The busing to and from these events has proved to be a challenge financially. Currently, the QACHS Student Government Association is financing the cost for not only the high school, but also Centerville Middle School, as well as any other secondary school that may happen to join in the future. In an effort to continue the growth of student leadership in Queen Anne's County, I request on behalf of the Queen Anne's County High School Student Government Association and the Northern Eastern Shore Association of Student Councils funding to pay for transportation to and from MASC and other leadership events. Thank you for your time and consideration on this matter.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sabrina.
Thank you.
That is the last on the list. Is there anyone else that would like to speak?
Good job. If not, we're going to move for the student member of the board's report.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
That was the most nervous I've ever been to do the Pledge of Allegiance, so thank you for that. You
did a great job.
Oh, thanks.
No notice.
So for Queen Anne's this month, we don't have much going on, mostly just sports, but we do have a couple things that will be happening in the next couple months that you can be getting ready for. Well, first, our second semester has started. Last semester, I'm ready for it to be over. We are having Soar Dunk come back. They are a dunking team, almost club from Liberty University, and they'll come and they'll do their little performance, and it's about like, they talk about like anti-bullying and all that stuff. So it's really cool, and it's cool to watch them. They'll be here on March 24th, so if you guys want to come out and see that. On April 30th, we are having a first annual 5K community day. It's called Team Austin with an M. And it's for all proceeds from this event will be put into the special needs program at our surrounding schools. So I think that's really cool. It's $30 registration, and there's a website you can go and log on if you want that. I can give it to you. And for sports, we have a lot of sports. Tonight was actually our wrestling senior night. That was cool. I was there for a little bit to see all my friends. Sad. And then they are wrestling against Kent Island on Friday. And then they have their Bayside Championships on the 19th and the Region Championships on the 24th through the 26th. Indoor on February 20th has their state championships. So this is the state championship month for everyone. And then for basketball, they play Kent Island at Queen Anne's on the 17th. So if you want to come out and see that, and Nam's not here, so I can't really trash talk her. Sorry. And then on the 21st and the 22nd will be our Bayside Championships at Cambridge South Dorchester, to be determined who we play. So yeah, very exciting.
All right, thank you very much. Following this, we have a presentation for the credit of the military for Mr. Farley.
Good evening, Mr. Paluski, members of the board.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Farley.
So as you may know, we've had interest from our employees about a practice that ended in 1999 in which we gave credit to new employees in their placement on the salary scales for military service. That stopped in 1999, and we have a number of veterans who have brought that up and would like to resolve the matter, which is appropriately done through collective bargaining. So I would like the board to follow through in consideration of bargaining that issue with the Maryland Association, Queen Anne's Association of Educators. The bottom line is that most other counties don't give credit for military service, and when they do, they give a flat dollar amount or they give one step. Our practice was giving up to two steps. So we'd like to recommend that moving forward, we negotiate a $5 amount to give to these members who served honorably for two or more years. And we're hopeful that that will move forward in time and treat all of our veterans equitably.
Thank you so much, Mr. Farley.
I move that we that we let Mr. Farley go forward to the bargaining table with potential flat rate stipend for the existing military members that did not receive it starting back in 1999, and potentially for all future ones that come in.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, I move for the vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, say no. The ayes have it.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Farley. Mr. Farley's doing double duty tonight.
Substitutes.
He's getting ready to do a presentation at the board's request on substitutes. She'll get it.
You got it, ma'am? I'm not sure. Do I need to move?
Is it green light on? It's coming into focus now.
Here it comes.
Pretty exciting having a countdown to your presentation.
Mm-hmm. Doesn't happen for everybody, Mr. Farley.
You're special tonight.
I know, you've been picking
on me.
You're
so easily entertained.
Alrighty. So the board asked that I give a presentation on our substitute teacher program, and I'm excited to do that. What we'll cover is a summary of the Queen Anne's County Public Schools substitute teacher program itself and as a whole, the process and procedures for hiring substitutes. We'll talk about substitute data points and have a little Q&A at the end. All of our substitutes have to apply through our online application system, and that helps give us diversity data and vet people from the very beginning. As candidates for substitute teachers. Their background checked at their own expense, which is currently $62. Everybody is given a one-on-one face-to-face orientation, a copy of the Queen Anne's County Substitute Teacher Handbook, and a copy of the substitute teacher textbook that we use. They're also trained on our policies and sign off on our policies, as do all other employees. We use technology called the Call Central system. Once the person is input as a record in that system, they can then enter their preferences for what schools they'd like to work in, whether or not they would like to work a longer term assignment, which gives them a little more money. And then the system, when a vacancy comes in, the system calls them and they can choose to take that opportunity. We have 134 current substitutes on our rosters for this year. 19 of them are certified teachers, 57 have bachelor's degrees or master's degrees, and 58 have an associate's degree or roughly equivalent, including a paraprofessional exam passage. Of the 134 substitutes, almost 100 are willing to take a long-term substitute assignment. But we still have about 7 unfilled substitute positions per day on average. And it goes up and down. We know when we're having in service or when we're having periods of particular peak illnesses. We do our very best to meet the needs, but we need more substitute teachers. This is a little bit hard to read, so for that I'll put my glasses on. But what you can see is that based on the data we've done, which is a per day payment of substitute teachers, we're paid about average, in fact, a little above average in some cases. So we know it's not just a money issue. It's also a situation where we need substitute teachers to feel a part of our schools and to be recognized for the contributions that they make so that others can get professional development or can take care of their sick child. So we want to continue to do more of that. That's it in a nutshell. Happy to answer any questions you might have.
Do we have set times of, like, during the month that we do orientations? Like, is there...
For substitutes?
Yes.
We do them as fast and one-on-one as we can. We know.
So anybody applies, and then it could be at any point that they would get.
We used to do them monthly, but we decided that that wasn't helping our schools.
Do you omit them from the list if they've refused? At one point, I think we omitted them if they've refused, you know, haven't grabbed an opportunity for a long period.
One refusal would not cause us to take them off the list.
That one.
We do have people that certain principals prefer or prefer not to use, and we try to take all that into consideration.
Do you stop calling if they haven't agreed to do it for months or whatever? Do you have a process like that?
Sometimes it'll just be a particular school that they won't want to go to, and so we watch for those patterns and then, you know, maybe adjust their record to reflect that. Thank you all for listening for a moment.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Farley.
Can you help with the tarpaulin? Okay.
You're next, Mr. Chair.
Do you have a presentation up here?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'll move again.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It is an honor and a pleasure to be on this side this evening. For the record, Greg Pluski, interim superintendent, and joining me, my esteemed colleague, Ms. Janet Pauls, our interim assistant superintendent for curriculum instruction. And this evening, we just wanted to provide you with an update regarding the Innovation Center. And as the board knows, back in July of 2016, Dr. Thunberg from Curriculum Management Associates presented to the board on the curriculum management audit. And in August of 16, I presented on what our response would be as a school system to the curriculum management audit. And that is simply one structure that we put in place, which is the Innovation Center. So really the purpose of the Innovation Center is a system-wide structure of how we organize people to get to the work, which is part of that is from the curriculum management audit. And really that is about student learning. That's the core of what we do, which is in teaching and learning. And if you remember back to the audit, that was the core component of alignment between curriculum and standards, instructional strategies and assessment. And so this structure, which we're gonna go an overview of our progress, is really to get people to think about some of the greatest challenges that we have in our school system and really create a culture around innovation and synergy on how to solve complex problems that get to closing the achievement gap. So this system-wide approach, as we talked about, is really how we're organizing in our response to the curriculum management audit. And we'll talk about the five themes that have emerged out of that. But what's happening is that we're building this culture around high collaboration between our administrators and our supervisors, our teacher specialists, as well as innovation. What does that mean for Queen Anne's County Public Schools? And it's really about connecting the dots. And it's about empowering folks to do the work and empower folks to bring their ideas to the table and value the input that they have. And so we're going to talk about today, and we're going to show you the platform that we've set up, but it's really the structure on how we're going to move those recommendations forward. And at the end of the day, it's really about how we work on the work. So if you remember from the curriculum audit when we launched the Innovation Center and upon entering the organization when I have back in 2015, that there were five themes that really emerged. And these themes were from a learning listening tour that I had done from listening to teachers and listening to principals and listening to supervisors. And those themes that you see before you have really served the foundation because that has become the voice
of those within the school system of these are areas that need attention. And really, they're the key drivers that drive any school system. So organizational excellence, early learning and school readiness, closing that achievement gap by the end of grade two, the core foundation of any school system, curriculum, instruction, the alignment. Remember, we talked about moving and implementing Common Core over the last, the Maryland College and Career Readiness Standards, the Common Core Standards over the last several years. Building our leadership pipeline, this is important, as well as building capacity, and that's about professional development. Any organization that thrives and improves has to invest in professional learning. That is a key component. And last is, how well are we doing? And that's really around monitoring progress and performance. How well are students when they enter our school system, as well as they're here with us, as well as that they exit our school system? Go ahead. So this visual, I think, is very important. And this is really how everyone in our school system, as I would say, has skin in the game. And the first is really is that board and the superintendent relationship about setting that vision and the expectations and the priorities of the school system, and working with then giving the superintendent to say, these are the areas to go ahead and work on. And that's part of the reason why we did the audit, was to help us narrow our focus. And really then allow the superintendent, as well as his executive team, to begin to start working on the work. And that's where the work that starts to take place in prioritizing that work within our school system and launching the Innovation Center. And really the heart of it, which is in the Innovation Center, and that's the work of those five areas and how we've organized the people to do the work. And so what's going to come out of the Innovation Center that you'll see in the next few months are those recommendations, the work. When the audit recommendation said the school system should have a policy on this, that's what you'll see come forward, is a policy on this. And so what's in red is really about implementing. So whether that's implementing something at a system level, whether that's implementing something at central office, or whether that's implementing at the key in our schools and in our classrooms, the Innovation Center serves as this checkpoint before that we go to implementation. So I'll give you a very good example of a recent initiative that would fall into this. If you remember a few years back when the school system decided to go with the elementary progress report as an example. So that would now, which would go through an innovation center, they would do the work, they would do the research on that, and they would bring that forward to the board as a recommendation, and then with a strategic rollout plan about how we would go about implementing that in the system. And that goes into the implementation phase. And then the last is really the Board of Education's responsibility. It's not only the fiscal responsibility, but keeping the board informed about the alignment of the goals that we're moving forward. So the Executive Oversight Committee, that is a key hub and link between you and the board and the members that are actually doing the work. So myself, I serve on that. Ms. Paul serves on that. Mr. Pinder serves on that. Ms. Landgraf serves on that. Mr. Modell, who's not here, serves on that. And Mr. Farley serves on that committee as well. We meet once a month with all these teams. We just met with them last Monday. And that gives us a chance as the leadership of the organization to ask questions about the work. Does the work need to go back? Does it need to be refined? Is a policy need to be refined before it comes to you as a recommendation? So we are a literally last stop before the work moves forward, so that we're sure that the work comes in on time, comes in on budget, and that we have a plan to roll out anything as we move forward. So what this visual really shows you is the vertical and horizontal alignment between that Executive Oversight Committee. And each of our five teams are broken down into senior project and process managers. So we have leaders that lead each one of those teams. And each one of those teams is held responsible to the recommendations that came out of the audit. One of the first things that we had done, and Ms. Pauls had led us through, was to take all those audit recommendations and then organize those into those five themes, five teams. So we've broken up all, there's eight areas of recommendation. There's over 54, 55 recommended items. And so we've broken all those items over five teams to spread out the work. The great thing about what Ms. Pauls led us through is she led all the ANS folks through that, and they determined which buckets they felt in those themes the work should be organized in. This is what Ms. Pauls is going to get ready to show you. I'm going to turn this over to her, and kudos to all the folks that have been involved in this. And I'm going to share, she's going to share with you our progress of what we've done to date and how the teams are set up, the work that they're doing, and how they're collaborating across the system, not only face-to-face, but virtually. My colleague, Ms. Pauls.
Thank you, Mr. Paluski. So in the essence of time, we're just going to take a quick perusal. If you have any questions, please feel free to call me, and I'd be happy to walk you through them. This is on a Google platform, so it's not anything in addition that we had to purchase. But we have each, if you see to the left where it says the navigation page, we have an overview, we have updates, but we have each of the five teams listed. And then for each of those teams, they have a section where they can outline their to-do list. They have a management report is what we use each month when we meet with the teams to update us on what's been done. And then we have another plan, an action management plan that they use as well too. But the overview here, again, it will tell you just what our work is. And then there's a space for collaboration. It shows you each of our five teams. And then it shows you the members on our team. So those five teams are comprised of building administrators, principals, assistant principals, also central office staff, supervisors, and teacher specialists are also included on these teams as well. So I'm just going to take you through one. I'm going to select curriculum instruction tools and assessment. So you just click on for that team. And again, you can see the members of the team. The senior project manager is Rob Watkins, the process manager, Tina Thomas, and the connector, Mr. Page. And the connector's job is to just kind of make sure that there's any type of communication with the other teams, because there are a few of the deliverables that do overlap. And then you can see all of the team members. You can go into each of their meetings, and you can see their agenda and their minutes that are listed, so you can see the progress that they have been making. It's all right there. All of the other teams have the opportunity to take a look at that as well. So what each team was asked to do was to prioritize and to try to limit it to about three deliverables. And so they had these huge, and it's another document in here, which I can show you a little bit later. It's a huge document, about 50 pages, that lists all of the audit findings, and we are now turning those into deliverables, and that means we're taking action on them. So you can see here, they prioritized four things for the beginning, for their first meeting. And those would then later become their deliverables. And we can go into each of the... each of the agenda minutes and find out what's there. But here we have our... where you can see where Team 3 has, again, prioritized what they're going to do. And then they have notes from each of their meetings. So for example, priority two for them was to develop a policy, a comprehensive curriculum management plan. And you can see the G21 here. It shows that it came from the audit findings under the governance section and what they're planning to do. So it's all outlined very clear for what the team has planned to do. And then we went back for our first oversight committee meeting, where the exec team was there, and exec team members, if you have anything to add, please feel free to join here. They have their action management report, and that's what we really take a look at to monitor their progress and where they are. I try to get into this site at least once a week, but here you can see, again, each of the teams are listed, but they talk about if the desired results have happened, and at this point we don't expect anything to have happened because we've been just really getting started. And then again, we still can't tell whether there's any impact at this particular point. And then they also talk about an estimated action plan date. So if they need any supports, we read through here and we're ready to discuss any of those actions with them when we meet with them. So I'd like to say that each and every team has been working very diligently. Yes. They have made great gains and during the process, and they found it to be extremely valuable. and feel as though they are now giving input into what is a very critical piece of what we do, and that's improving instruction for all students. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. Again, you can see here the calendar is listed, the budget summary, which we don't have very much of at this particular point in time because we are just getting started. But again, I can't give enough kudos to each of the teams for all of the work that they have done. They've made tremendous strides. Excuse me. They have learned how to work together virtually so that they don't all have to be together. And then they have some face-to-face meetings as well, too. Questions?
So one of the things that you'll see as a next step, probably at the next board meeting, is that Ms. Pauls will do a little bit of an update on the Innovation Center. But what you'll start to see are those teams coming to you. So those project and process managers that are doing the work, and they're going to share the work with you, what they're working on, what's moving forward. And so you'll start to get updates, and you'll start to see this work, especially in policy development, really start to come forward to you. So we're planning those over the next several board meetings. So you'll get it in small doses, but you'll get to see who's leading the work, who's doing the work. And I would just like to echo what Ms. Paul said. I don't think that we couldn't be more pleased with the work that has happened. And one of the things that I'm noticing is that not only are they beginning to work together in a different way, in a new way, and they're working virtually, but what we're finding is they're seeing the bigger picture of how these pieces fit together and the collaboration and the thinking that's going behind, how do we think about instruction? Yeah, we need to think about how we're implementing that. So I couldn't be more pleased. And we'd be happy to take any questions or comments that you have.
I like it. It's very well organized and structured. Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
Thank you.
Yes,
I have a question. How we link the budget process to this. I mean, maybe too early to affect the process that we're working on now, but
yes. Yes, we're a few steps behind. Mm-hmm. So once this really gets moving, and what we'll start to see is budget requests come forward. So actually, we're in the best place for setting up FY19, because as this moves forward into the fall, I can tell you, even from our very first meeting, I sat down with Rob, and she said, these are already requests that are being made. And I said, well, we're not there yet. So the thinking's there, and I think once we go into the FY19, you'll start to see some of that work come forward as a request.
The other piece of that, Captain Kelly, too, was when they put together their budget request for this year, they had to align it with one of our instructional goals. So they really are starting to think about how what they request is aligned to the needs of the system. And that was kind of their first starting point. And now, again, they're really getting into it and really thinking about the request, because one of the teams had requested an additional staff person. And when we started to talk about it with the exec team, they said, well, you know, now that I think about it, this could probably be a combined decision. So again, they are really driving the bus and making the recommendations as to what is a priority and what's not. So lots of autonomy.
And to that, what we're also finding is we're building an internal leadership structure that folks are getting the opportunity to lead, and they're getting autonomy to lead. And I think that's healthy for an organization, because as they prepare for their next level of work, this is going to help them in that process of that level of work. The other thing I'd like to add to that very quickly is that we presented the state of the schools to the business community a few weeks ago, and I know many of you were there and appreciate that support. What I found interesting were some of the business folks that I spoke with that said, how can I be a part of that? That's the kind of synergy and connectedness when you can get other folks to connect to this work, builds a greater sense of the value of the work to move forward. And I really appreciate the leadership of our folks that are doing the work.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good job. Thank you, Mrs. Pauls and Mr. Poliski. At this time, do you want to take a break?
Okay.
Take a break. Next, we'll move down to the individual action items. H&R report, transportation report. Mr. Sid.
Yes, for transportation report, we have two substitute bus drivers, Danae Brown and Brad Dean, who have met all the requirements set forth by the Queen Anne's County Public School System and need to be approved tonight to be substitutes.
Need a motion to accept the substitute drivers.
So moved.
Can I get a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, we'll move for the vote for the transportation report, the new substitute drivers. All in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed, say no. The ayes have it. I said HR report first. Who has it? Okay. Next, we'll go back up for the HR report.
We've submitted the HR report, and it reflects the additions and subtractions of teachers and staff from our employ, and I would ask you for a motion to approve.
I make a motion that we approve the HR report as presented in closed session.
Do I have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to accept the HR report as accepted in closed session. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, I call for the vote. All in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed, say no. The ayes have it. Next, we'll do our field trip to Queen Anne's County High School. Did we have one?
Do you want me to just make a motion?
A motion recommend
okay.
to the...
I make a motion that we approve the field trip to for the Queen Anne's County High School AP Science class to Echo Hill Outdoor School, April 19th through the 21st, 2017.
Motion, do I have a second?
I second.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, I call for the vote for the field trip to Queen Anne's County High School AP Science class to Echo Hills Outdoor School for April the 19th through the 21st, 2017. All in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed, say no. The ayes have it. The policy for the final and third reading.
Yes, this is the third and final reading for graduation exercises, and I don't believe, Mr. Farley, that we've received any public comment. Ms. Pauls, I don't believe that we've received any public comment. So our recommendation would be to approve the policy on graduation exercises at this time.
Can I have a motion to second?
Second.
I have a motion that has been seconded for the third final reading for the graduation exercise policy. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, we'll move for the vote. All in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed, say no. The ayes have it.
This is the approval, right? It's approved.
Yes. Yeah.
So they're moving it forward now.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah, so we'll move that forward in our process to.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
We'll post that policy now on the school system website as approved by the board and number it.
For our future action items, policies, is this the final read?
It's actually the first read.
First read. Mm-hmm. For the four policies, recruitment of selection of staff and leadership development and section planning, Americans with Disabilities Act, accommodations in employment and compensation.
So these are four new policies that we're putting forward, and they'll go out with your approval for public comment, however it's first read. Mr. Farley, is there anything that you'd like to add relative to those four policies?
No, I think they speak for themselves.
I move that we send these policies forward for the first read.
Okay, have a motion. Second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to send forth the reading for these four policies. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. Any questions or any comments? Ayes have it. Next, we'll have the interim superintendent's report, Mr. Gregory Poliski.
Sure, just to highlight a couple things. First of all, would like to recognize Ms. Pauls as well as our principals. Ms. Pauls and I have been on a whirlwind tour of all of our schools, doing our site visits, and there are so many wonderful things happening in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. It is awesome to see learning at its best and happen each and every day. And that is a tribute to our teachers and our administrators that make that happen on a daily basis. I'm so proud of what I've seen. There are always areas of improvement. There's always work to do. As you know, we're looking to close that achievement gap. And this has been a great opportunity for us to talk with principals around their school improvement plans, around the gaps that they're seeing within their buildings. So very pleased with our site visits, and we'll certainly go to work on some next steps. The second thing I wanted to highlight is each month, and I'd like to recognize Karen Field. She's here this evening. Karen and I have not only won a great relationship, but each month Karen and I meet on a regular basis, and Karen has been so gracious to organize, whether it's an elementary group of teachers, a middle school group of teachers, or a high school group of teachers, and we meet monthly and listen to what the concerns of teachers are, what's going well, what's not going well, where are their areas of concern. And as an example, I'll give a very good example of this. Karen and I just met, we met with a group of elementary teachers, and they had concerns about the calendar, and they had concerns about professional development days, and Karen and the group had requested if they could meet with us and had some ideas. So Mr. Farley, Mr. Brown met with them on a calendar committee, I think it was four or five, and they had some recommendations and some ideas. And so I want to recognize Karen for her leadership and that voice that she brings with our teachers, which is so vital. And I think what it's allowed is this open dialogue and communication that helps us. And in that case, Mr. Farley and Mr. Brown for organizing that meeting and opening that dialogue and listening to them and the concerns that they had. There are lots of things that are happening in our school system. Those are two key things I just wanted to bring and highlight. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Poliski. Next, we'll have the curriculum and the instruction report by Assistant Superintendent Ms. Janet Pauls.
Good evening. So you can see the curriculum and instructional team has been very busy again. We have about 36 pages here of what we have been doing. But I ditto what Mr. Poliski stated. We have visited just about every school. Tomorrow is Mattapique Middle School and Mattapique Elementary School, and we just have APA left. So we really did take a whirlwind tour during the month of January. We saw some exceptional instruction in all of those schools and had the opportunity to converse with some exceptional students. And we did have the opportunity to visit Ms. Field's class, where she was co-teaching with Ms. Julie Kimball, and we saw an exceptional example of how two teachers co-teach and work extremely well together. We've also taken some of our curriculum supervisors with us, and it's been a great dialogue for them to see what we are observing and what we're looking for, and then for them to tell us, because they're the content experts, to tell us what they would be looking for. So it's really been a great time for us, even though it's been very busy. Again, I'd like to give kudos to the innovation team. They have done so much work, and also to the executive oversight team for taking the time to read through all the documents. Huge kudos to our interim assistant superintendent, Mr. Poliski, who spoke at the chamber breakfast, and I received so many positive comments regarding his talk. And so it was an honor to certainly be there and be a part of that breakfast and his talk. And then I'll end with, on the 25th, we had professional development in every school. And every school but two schools had cultural bias. And as I visited Queen Anne's County High School, one of the teachers said, as I was exiting her room, she said to me, "This is the best professional development I have ever had. And she said, I thoroughly enjoyed it. Please thank the person that's responsible for it. So again, we give kudos to our fearless leader here, who's doing an exceptional job of bringing us what we need to move the system forward. So, thank you.
Good, thank you.
And I've heard many compliments also from Queen Anne's County High School about that. They were really very happy to.
I did too.
Many of the teachers that we received emails from, elementary teachers that were. That were delighted with that. They got a lot of work done, is what a lot of the teachers' comments had said.
It was great. We were at the high school for a little bit of it.
Yes, and cultural proficiency
open,
training.
Tears, honesty, it was great.
Good.
Good, good. Thank you, Ms. Pauls. Next, we'll have our expenditure report by our Chief Financial Officer, Ms. Robin Langriff.
Okay, once again, this month, you have two reports in front of you. Report number one is at a very high level. It's the at category level, administration, mid-level. And you can see, if you look at the right-hand side of the report, essentially we are in the 90 to 95% spent in most of the categories at this point in the year. And that's really obligated money because we go ahead and we obligate all the salaries and whatnot. Overall, we're at 91% spent. And I compared that to previous years, and we're within a quarter of a percent of where we were this time last year. So we're in really good shape. There are a couple line items within the budget that we are going to have to identify funds to transfer into those line items because they are overspent at this time. The one in particular that I'm looking at is special education non-public placements. We have a couple students who have been placed in a non-public school where we have to pay the tuition, and we had one very expensive one that we were not expecting this year, and we're going to be about $125,000 over in that line item. So I've got to identify funds to move to that line item to cover it. I think that's our worst case situation at the moment, so we'll be identifying those funds and requesting that transfer in the next month. Any questions on the report?
I do, Robin. I guess this is something I can ask. So next year we'll have that identified as a line item that is needed. It came to us after the budget was set up for this year, and so it was a surprise.
That's correct.
Next year That's we already correct. Know it's got to be there.
Yes, and actually I've talked to the supervisor of special education. We've looked at the students who are in those non-public placements right now. Some of them will be graduating out. And we anticipate that the money that's currently in there should cover what our expenses should be for next year.
But we do not ever know about an emergency or a surprise that we can't anticipate.
Okay. That's exactly right. We can have any student move into the county at any time. If they're already in a placement, then we would honor that until we were able to have a formal IEP meeting and be able to determine whether that placement needed to continue or not.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Langriff. And next is the legislative update. I believe you can refer to the MABE's green sheet with some discrepancies in the date. So I guess we can refer to the MABE's green sheet. Is that correct?
Right. And when there's any updates, I just couldn't make that meeting. We had a retreat that day, and that's the first meeting of the strongest meeting before the legislature opened up. So I'm just reading it like you guys are right now. I'll try to update us each time we have a meeting. But that was a big meeting.
All righty. Thank you. Kelly, next was citizen participation or public comments. Mr. McNeil's gone.
I'd like to speak. Mm-hmm. Like to say, anybody like
yes, anybody would like to have any remarks or comments at this time?
Well, I guess I would.
All right, come on up.
Put it like that. Mm-hmm. So I represent Sodexo. You guys met me at the last board meeting. I'm Bruce Forgrave, the general manager. So I was making a proposal. I talked to Sid the other day about, it was Jackie. About maybe getting one of the board members to join me in one of the schools for lunch for the next 4 months. So it's something that maybe you guys could consider. And I was going through Jackie. I don't know if she talked to Arlene about it.
Yes, we've recently discussed it.
So your feedback, you know, I'm always welcoming your feedback, so it's something that I would like to do. I would like to propose. If someone can do it, great. Elementary, middle school, high school, you can meet with us.
Great.
So at this point, you know, since I just started, I am looking for, you know, feedback from my employees and everybody. So thank you very much.
Thank you. The upcoming meetings and events will be attended by three or more board members in the next following weeks, February the 13th, 2017. A board work session from 11 a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m. And March the 1st is our board meeting. Anybody have any?
12:30 to 2 on
yeah,
the 13th.
Yeah, we
changed
the time.
On the 13th. 12:30 to 2.
You told me.
I didn't have to say it, but I didn't know she was going to say 11 to 2 either.
12:30 to 2
o'clock.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Arlene.
You're quite welcome.
And I think this might just be a misprint, Miss Jackie, but on the 7th SES volunteer orientation, 8:30 p.m. and 12:30 p.m. It should be 8:30 a.m.
Which sheet are you looking at?
The calendar. Events calendar that okay. We just got.
Okay, Denise will make that correction. Which day is it?
It says February 7th. It says SES volunteer orientation, 8:30 p.m. and 12:30 p.m. I'm thinking it might supposed to mean 8:30 a.m.
Geneva.
Okay. Sorry, Geneva. This looks like it should be an A instead of a P.
In the morning,
that's what I thought, but okay.
Okay.
Any more input from our interim superintendent? Anything you want to say?
I'm good.
All righty, I need a motion to adjourn the meeting.
So moved.
And second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or any comments? Hearing none, we'll move for the vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you can thank Jackie.
She texted us.